So today, we will be talking about the content-based instruction, including of what does it really mean, the rationale of content-based instruction, and lastly, the theoretical foundations of content-based instruction. So first, let us talk about the definition of content-based instruction based on what we have researched. So when we say content-based instruction, it is an approach to language teaching that focuses not on the language itself, but rather on what is being taught. In this kind of approach, it has been said that the content and language are being integrated. It focused on content or information that students will acquire, not around the linguistic or other type. So, content-based instruction, as what I have said, is an approach to language teaching that focuses on content. But although it is the combination of content and language, still, the emphasis is put on content rather than on the language itself. But still, ang language ang mag-serve as medium, di ba? Or ang vehicle in learning something new or to learn what is being expected to know. Kay, unsaon ang pagkahibalo if dili magamit sa language, how could the learner convey meanings or to communicate from one another if walay language? So basically, ang content-based instruction is more on learning about something rather than learning about language. Yet, the students are also expected to learn a language. But as what I have said, dili jud sa language ang direct nga focus sa teaching. It's like they will only learn the language by using it within the specific context. And ang language nga gamiton is ang language nga ginatry ug learn nila, not the native language. So this is somehow a tool for developing knowledge, for developing something new, and so that they would also develop their linguistic ability in the target language. So importante ang, or more like advantage sad ang content-based instruction, because the learners will be able to gain intrinsic motivation, like they will more likely engage on content jud. It will heighten their motivation, they will become more independent, and they will be able to use their advanced thinking skills in learning something new, in learning something bag-o nila, and by that, they will only give less focus of the structure of the language. So, kanina lang, I mentioned about content. So, unsa man ang pasabot sa content-based instruction. So, what can be considered content? Content refers to what is being taught or discussed through the language and not be language instruction related. It refers to something that the learners are expected to know. So actually, there are many things that can be considered as content. But when we say content in content-based instruction, it pertains to something that is expected to learn, a subject matter, or like an academic subject siya, ang substance o ang unod sa whole nga lesson. Take for example, kung about history, kung about science, or about social studies, so mo na siya ginatawag og content, and ana ka jud i-focus ang kanang learning process sa content ra mag-focus. So mo na to nga in learning the content, mag-use na sa language in conveying meanings. And as what I've said, yun na encourage ang learners nga ang target language jud ang ilang i-exercise in conveying meanings, in communicating to one another.
So this time, let us talk about the different rationale of content-based instruction.
So there are 7 strong rationales for content-based instruction. First is the exposure to a considerable amount of language while learning content and is linked to their prior learning and relevant to their needs. In this, interesting content is used and students are engaged in language-dependent activities. And language use are not learned through direct instruction, but rather acquired naturally or automatically.
The second one is contextualized learning. It captures the learner's attention and promotes learning retention of specific knowledge, skills, or behavior. It provides learning materials that somehow relatable to students, wherein students can come up meaning based from their experience. The third one is increased opportunities to use language and expertise they bring to class. So the learners are expected to use the language too, since gamitin man sad nila na i-convey ang meaning sa klase. And they are encouraged to use the target language while they are in the learning process. And they are given opportunities which can develop learner skills, abilities, and knowledge in the classroom. So it utilizes language and ability of a learner. And the fourth one is increased motivation or complex information leads to intrinsic motivation. Through CBI or content-based instruction, learners will heighten their motivation because they are being exposed to multiple opportunities and challenging tasks. So eventually, makagain sila og motivation to develop their thinking skills during learning. The definition of intrinsic motivation is the act of doing something without any obvious external reward.
The fifth one are cooperative, apprenticeship, experiential, and project-based learning. Basically, the learners are exposed to group tasks wherein they are allowed to mingle with other classmates, and the tasks that will be provided are those that would train them. Cooperative learning involves students working together to accomplish shared goals, and it is this sense of interdependence that motivates group members to help and support each other. Apprenticeship. One cannot learn from afar. Instead, one learns amid the engagement of participating in the authentic, dynamic, and unique swirl of genuine practice. Experiential. The strategic, active engagement of students in opportunities to learn through doing and reflection on these activities, which empowers them to apply their theoretical knowledge to practical endeavors in a multitude of settings inside and outside of the classroom. The last one is project-based learning. This approach is increasingly used to subject domains where the knowledge base is rapidly expanding and where it is impossible for students to master all the knowledge in the domain within a limited period of study. Working in groups, students identify what they already know, what they need to know, and how and where to access new information that may lead to resolution of the problem. The sixth is flexibility can adjust class to students' interests. It is more like the mentor will do the adjustments in the class. Like in providing the learning tasks, the interests of the students must also be considered. So it allows educators to respond to different learning abilities, needs, and interests. It enables learners to generate new ways to solve a problem, adapt to changes in routines, and adjust to the unexpected. Educators should be mindful in selecting and adapting the learning materials.
It should be authentic and relevant.
And the seventh one, which is the last one, is student-centered classroom. A student-centered classroom or student-centered learning environment is one where the focus of instruction is shifted from the teacher to the student, with the end goal of developing students who are autonomous and independent by placing the responsibility of learning in the hands of the students. One of the goals of content-based instruction is to produce students who are independent and autonomous. So that is why in class, they are trained and got challenged with the test so that they will become independent in the learning process. More like ang classroom kay student-centered, dili passive kay i-involved jud ang students, and the learners are allowed to work on their own too.
This time, we will be talking about the theoretical foundations of CBI. So based among the research, there are two theoretical foundations of content-based instruction. first is the cognitive learning theory, which has three underlying stages, and the second one is called second language acquisition, or SLA. So the first theory is cognitive learning theory. In this process, students progress through a series of three stages. So the first stage is called cognitive. When we say cognitive, it pertains to the mental skills, memorization, and the learner has to think how to execute such skill. So in this stage, this is when a learner starts thinking on how to do such skill. It is more on analyzing kung unsa ang pag-perform sa task and mo succeed ana at the end. So let us take this as an example, like sa duwa nga football. So at first, the learner of course will observe pa siya or yang i-prepare ang yang kagalingon kung on how to do such task, what are the necessary kanang steps, unsaon niya pag-execute. So makaingon ta nga sa cognitive, more on preparation jud siya, wherein the mental thinking of a learner will be exercised. So the next stage is called associative. So associative, in this stage, it has something to do with the application. A learner will then try to perform such task by himself but still need support along the process. So application na siya after na maka-figure out ang learner kung unsaon pag-perform ang task. So iyan ang buhaton. The learner can perform a task na but still mag-seek sad siya og outside support, may it be from his or her colleagues or sa iyang kauban or sa iyang teacher. So lastly is the autonomous. So autonomous, the learner can finally perform the task automatically and autonomously. So finally, sa aning stage, the task representation is increasingly refined. Why? Because the learner can finally perform the task automatically and autonomously. So it means independent na ang learner when performing a task. They can take charge of their learning and conscious na sila during sa learning process.
So the second theoretical foundation is called second language acquisition. Literacy development can be facilitated with multiple opportunities and authentic materials. So this means that learners are facilitated with multiple opportunities, authentic and challenging materials, those that would challenge the learners and those that are relevant to the language learning activities. So that's all, and thank you for listening.